Surrey. For leaving what we begun, there's someone for me somewhere, and I still miss someone. Though I never got over those blue eyes, I see them everywhere. I miss those arms that held me when all of love was there, when all of love was there.
You are listening to WOOPLP, Cleveland, Tennessee. WHOOP FM is a broadcasting service of the Traditional Music Resource Center, and we play America's original music.
Good morning and welcome to Old Town Cleveland here on WHOOP FM 99.9. Or you can go to the internet at www.whoopfm.com. You can call us here at 614-5553. Good morning, Debbie Moore. Tell me what's going on.
Good morning, Ron. It's Heart Radio, October the 8th, 2016. We've had some very severe weather out on the coast. Our prayers go out to all those folks that are dealing with all that water right now. And we were a little inconvenienced by the storm, but nowhere near what those folks are suffering. We had planned a nice long trip to Charleston, South Carolina, and about Thursday I said, I think we better not do that.
Yeah, we were going to leave at 12 today, and we may wait another month or two before we go.
Yeah, everything comes down there. Before we get started, if I could please take just a couple minutes to announce, because there's a lot of good things going on in the community today. Of course, Prater's Meal down at Radlin Gord's old place down in Dalton, Georgia, is they're having their annual Prater's Meal celebration today and tomorrow. Also, our good buddy P. Dab and his friends are out at Mount Olive Church of God this morning with their big quilt show that they always have. And I'm pretty sure you might get you something good to eat out there and look at a lot of beautiful quilts. Of course, the Historical Society meeting is tomorrow. Ron, can you tell us what the program is going to be?
Yes. Gary OMB, a local radio announcer, done sports broadcasts on BAC and now works for 103.1, I believe, is the station now that does the Bradley football. Gary last year wrote a book about the 100 years of Bradley basketball. This is the 100th year of the school, so he wrote a book about that. Had all pictures and stats of every game, boys and girls. And so he took upon himself to write 100 years of Bradley football, and it will go all the way through this season, which will be truly 100 years of records for Bradley High School. Tons of pictures. He's going to be the guest speaker at the Bradley County Historical and Genealogical Society tomorrow at 2:30 at the community room in the Cleveland Public Library. The public is invited. It's free. He'll have a lot of pictures. He'll have the PowerPoint presentation, be showing that, and talk about if you're a historian or a genealogical person, probably you got a lot of your family members are going to be mentioned and
in the book,
and then a lot of pictures of your family, so a lot of local people, and so some of your ancestors.
And
literally
I would,
could be in
yes,
this one now.
Yes, it really could be. And when you go in the public library there, you enter at Church Street, of course, and just go in the front doors and keep walking straight, and you'll get to the big community room. It holds about 100 people, I believe. The last time we met and we showed the Ducktown documentary, we had her full.
Right.
It couldn't have got one more person in there, and it was a wonderful day. Also up in Athens, our friends up in Athens are having the Pumpkin Town Festival today, and they call it that because there's pumpkins right now, and to the fact that before it was Athens, Tennessee, it was Pumpkin Town, and a lot of good things going on up there. And then go up and visit our friends at the Charleston City Park. Today's their antique tractor show.
And
from 9:30 to 3 p.m.
And probably more important than anything right now, the Fat Cats will put out a new album in just a few weeks.
And if you were listening right before the show, you were hearing songs from that.
So the Fat Cats are
quite entertaining.
John Cook and myself, we got 12 new songs that we've written. A lot of them talk about us probably getting older. Because we are getting older.
Well, Gary and I are not in that group, are we, Gary?
Good morning.
Good morning. We have Gary Miller with us today, and we always enjoy having, we've had him on once before, and we talk about his adventures in the movies and his years maybe at Bradley High School and anything that we want to talk about. So we are glad to welcome Gary here with us this morning.
Gary probably remembers some of those basketball and football games from his days at Bradley.
I attended most of them. I graduated in, you know, with you in 71. And there were very few, during my 4 years, there were very few basketball or football games that I missed. I attended regularly. I was a fan fanatic.
Well, so was I. I was there quite often and still going. In fact, the scores from this weekend, Bradley beat a powerful Kingsport Dobbin Bennett team, 41-31, I believe was the final score last night. Walker Valley beat Saudi Daisy, 61-28. I may have that number wrong. That was on Thursday night. And Cleveland lost by one touchdown to Ray County. They are on their fifth string quarterback now. And
every week somebody gets injured, it's awful.
Well, you know, they're and at Cleveland, most of the players are having to go both ways. So when you lose your quarterback, you also lose your safety. And when you lose your cornerback, you're losing next year, so they're really down. But Ray County defeated once only by Baylor, perfect in their district. Cleveland gave them a scare last night, so that's good. Polk County won, beat Brainerd, so it sets up a big matchup coming up in a few weeks. Bradley and Maryville, two undefeated teams in the state. Here we're at Bradley High School. That will be a big match, and get you tickets early. It's going to be a crowd.
Our son-in-law, Dustin, said on Facebook this morning that 7-0 for Bradley Bears for the first time since 1976.
I think so.
So that's, Ron still follows them quite closely, Gary, and has since high school.
Well, I usually try to make it up at least once, you know, one game a year, and I've been kind of targeting that Maryville game. That's the game that I want to come up and see, and I've followed them, you know, through the banner and the Times Free Press, and I keep
you know,
paying.
Our local newspaper does such an outstanding job trying to cover all the sports. Ron, is that the one that might be televised?
ESPN will not carry it. It's going to be a Thursday night game. ESPN wants it on Friday. But I think Bradley's already contracted with a Knoxville TV station and a Chattanooga station to play that. So if you can't get out to the game or if it's bad weather and you'd like to stay in, there will be one of the Chattanooga stations. This one, it won't be on Channel 3. It'll be one of their sub-channels out there, CW
Fox
or something like that, that they play a lot of football games on. But it will be the game. And if they're both undefeated going in, which both of them have a chance to be, that will be great. And if you don't know anything about football, Maryville in the last 14 years has lost four ball games, and two of those were playing for the state championship. So that just tells you what kind of level of team they had. They lost to Crosstown Traffic. Crosstown Traffic. That's we were talking about Jimi Hendrix earlier. The Crosstown rival there that by Alcoa, which is always a powerhouse in their division. So that Maryville just hasn't lost in a long, long time. But
well, we hope that we help them end that winning streak.
That streak has to end sometime, and we wouldn't mind it being in 2 weeks here. So, Gary, tell us you have done for your, since you left Bradley High School and what you did for a living most of your life before we get into the good the stuff you're doing now.
Well, I, over the years, I primarily have been in sales and sales management over the years, and then more recently, going back to early 2000s, of actually started companies, grown them, franchised them, and then sold my equity in them. So just been had a lot of fun as far as doing that sort of thing. And then, as it turned out, going back to 2012, when I was sitting in my office one day, I was listening to the radio, and I knew that they had been talking about filming the movie 42 in Chattanooga at Ingalls Stadium. And my wife Sherry and I, we go to a lot of movies. You know, after church on Sundays, a lot of times we'll take off or on Saturday afternoons go to the matinees to see movies. And I've always been a baseball guy. And I thought, well, how much fun would it be to go, you know, be able to go sit in the stands and, you know, see how a baseball movie is being made. So they were having a casting call at Eastgate Center. So just, I heard them say, this was at 10:30 in the morning, I heard them say at 11, from 11 to 3 today at Eastgate, we're going to have a casting call. And just, I kind of laughed to myself, and I just dropped what I was doing, got in the car, drove to Eastgate, stood in line with hundreds of people. They handed me a clipboard with a sheet of paper to fill out. And so while you fill it out while you're standing in line, get up there, you hand the paper to the people, they take two or three pictures of you, and boom, you're gone. So, I mean, it was just that quick, that simple. And when I got home that night, I was, you know, telling Sherry, I was laughing really about, you know, the crazy thing that I did just on a whim, an impulse. And she said, well, did you put down that you had umpiring experience? Because after high school, I umpired for a few years. And I said, no. And she said, well, you need to let them know that you umpired. I said, really? And she said, yeah, I do that. So I sent an email to the casting company, and then weeks went by, and I just told her, I said, well, I'm not even going to be able to sit in the stands to watch the movie, but that's just the way it goes. It's okay. It was interesting, you know, going
through. I know there were hundreds of people that showed up dressed that ended up sitting, that didn't even make it to the stands, that had been selected. So just to be picked is incredible.
Well, after I had kind of given up being able to sit in the stands, I got an email late one Thursday evening saying, can you be in Atlanta Tuesday morning at 10 o'clock to audition for an umpire's role in 42? So I responded yes.
Yes, yes.
So I, not knowing what to expect, I showed up and went in, and there were either 18 or 19 active umpires from all over the Southeast who were there. And I just kind of shook my head. I thought, wow, okay, this is not necessarily going to be good, but it'll be interesting. So I sat down, and they had a conference. We were out in a waiting area, and they had a conference room where they had Brian Hegland, who was the director. Brian Hegland, who was the director of 42, was an Oscar winner for L.A. Confidential, if anyone ever saw that movie. And so he and the casting director in the conference room, and one at a time would, you know, call the umpires in and for a private conversation and an audition. So I was watching my watch, and they usually took 12 to 15 minutes per umpire. Mm-hmm. And so therefore I get called in, introduced, you know, we talked for a second. He, you know, said, you know, show me an out call, a safe. You know, we talk a little
bit. Did you do a RICO for him? You remember RICO?
Oh.
Yeah.
Striker there.
Yeah.
Well, I remember him. But then it was just like what you would you hear stereotypically. It was, thank you for coming in today. We appreciate you coming in. If we're interested, we'll let you know. And so I walk out, and I look down at my watch, and I've been in there for 7 minutes.
And you thought,
I knew what that meant. So I got in the car, driving back home. I, you know, gave Sherry a call, and I laughed and told her that. And so I said, well, I've got a good story. I actually went on an audition with for a big-time movie
happy.
Director.
Yeah,
I was happy at that point. I was satisfied. So, again, weeks go by, and all of a sudden I get an email that says, you have been selected to be a major league umpire in 42. And they filmed all the major league scenes in Chattanooga at Ingalls Stadium. They did the Negro League scenes in Macon, Georgia. They did the minor league scenes down in Birmingham. And so I ended up working 14 days in Chattanooga on 42.
Now, let me stop you here. Did you have any acting experience?
Well,
yeah, just little things.
He acted like he knew what was going on.
That's true. Well, actually at Bradley, and I'll give Warnie Fennell the credit. We had class night, mm-hmm. and so my sophomore, junior, and senior year, I was in the play. Each of those times,
I'm actually a year behind you, and I was in the plays right behind. Yeah, I was in your senior year. I was a junior in our plays. So.
So and that was it. So after high school, absolutely none. It was just something that I did because it was fun that with a lot of my friends that, we got together and it was just an enjoyable thing. So as far as acting experience,
that was high school, 30 years ago or more.
So how much screen time did you get in 42?
I actually got, if anyone is familiar with the movie, there's the scene where the main game where the Phillies manager is really saying the most disgusting vile things to Jackie, and I'm the home plate umpire in that scene.
Okay.
So I got I got a little bit of FaceTime there, and but that's all good when you're acting and you're working on a movie. Mm-hmm. That's the reward, just the experience.
To be surrounded by those people.
And just to be able to go through the process to see how it's done and how everyone acts and what the directors are looking for, mm-hmm. and try to be able to give them what they're looking for. And when the movie comes out, if you're seen in it at all, that's just icing on the cake.
Our son was there on 42, and he was sitting. He was working, so he wasn't sitting where the cameras were. But the guy came up to him, the one that was the coach, that said all the vile things, and he was practicing with Will. He'd say, what if I yell? And he would say something, and Will was like, oh, I don't talk like that. I don't know if that's the right thing to say. And Will said it was the most interesting, uncomfortable few minutes of his life.
Yes.
That he'd say, well, what about if I yell this? And he'd yell out some horrible thing, and everybody sitting in the stands would go, oh. But they had to learn not to react that way.
Well, prior to shooting the scene, the director made the announcement to the crowd saying, the scene that we're about to film is going to be authentic. It's going to be disgusting. It's going to be vile. If you are offended by racially insensitive language, we would like for you to leave now. You will be welcome back, mm-hmm. whenever the scene is finished. But this is history. This is what actually happened, and worse. And so they gave everyone fair warning, mm-hmm. that if mm-hmm. you didn't want to hear it or didn't want to be exposed to the racial epithets that they were about to endure, that you could excuse yourself.
It was when he came home, he was going wide-eyed. Oh, my gosh. I love the story about when you guys were filming and the director wanted the calls to be made one way. Please tell that little story.
Actually, this was like on day three or four of the 14 days. And I had a couple of my friends that I had they said, we need, as it turned out, they ended up needing some additional umpires. And I said, well, I know a couple of guys that I can bring in. And one of them was Jim Reynolds in Chattanooga, who's on talk radio there. Go to church with Jim. And so I contacted Jim. He came to work there, and we were filming, and it was it was either day three or four. You had the main director, who was Brian Heglin, and then there was the baseball unit director, who was another fella. He looked like Dick Butkus, if anyone's familiar with the old Chicago Bears, middle linebacker Dick Butkus, big gruff guy, and he was gruff. He was responsible for all the baseball players and everything. And we were filming a scene, and Jim made the comment, you know, to the direct the baseball director, that umpire or that player would have done this and we would have done that, and he looked around at Jim and he says, "Are you the director here?"
Oh,
and Jim just kind of laughed. It's fine. Put his hands up. He's no sir, not me. I'm just trying to share some information. He said, "Okay, then that's all I need to know. Just you know, in other words, go away."
Mm-hmm. And don't be that guy. Yeah.
And so the next morning, and that was last. That was Jim's last day. He had to go back to work. That was day four. Day four. So Jim had to go back to work the next day. But the next morning when we got there, one of the assistant directors came over to us, the umpires, and he said, last night the conversation came up in the meeting about, you know, the post-day meeting about what one of the umpires said. And with, you know, the baseball director was not pleased, and then he found out that all of you guys were real umpires.
Yes.
And
real
at that umpires. Point, yeah, and at that point, the assistant director said he had some very colorful language that he used, and he says, it's very nice of you guys to let me know that these guys know what they're doing. And so at that point, he told us, the baseball director, he said, guys, he said, you do it the right way. He said, we'll listen to what you have to say. If we need to do something different for the sake of a camera angle, we'll do that. But I'm going to rely on you guys. You just do your jobs, and we'll follow from that standpoint. And he said, also, from this day forward, we'd like to invite you to join the cast and crew for your meals.
Wow. So that was a step up.
That was really a step up. And that was part of the real nice experience. So instead of getting the box.
Sorry, it's like sitting with the popular kids at
lunch. Oh, yes. it's much better food and stuff.
Yeah, well, I'm here now. Hi.
Morgan has slid in. This is Morgan. He is our intern from Bradley High School.
Very good.
And he's usually on time.
Yeah, usually.
Well, this is Gary Miller.
Nice to meet you, Gary Miller.
And Gary went to school with Ron at Bradley, and he one day started acting in movies. Started out on a little film.
He's going to do a few others that you know too.
You'll enjoy the conversation.
So, I was actually going to mention that my cousin actually was also in 42 as a reporter.
Oh, really?
My cousin Jimmy Patterson. I keep forgetting his last name.
Don't say things like that, Morgan. So he was one of the reporters. It was a great experience for most everyone.
How much big money did you make? Were you able to retire completely after working on 42?
That's very funny. That's very funny. No, I was hired as an extra on 42, part of the way through the filming, I truly got upgraded to actor status. They came to me. I was sitting up in the stands.
That's crazy.
And they said, here in about 20 minutes, first of all, they said, here's paper in quadruplicate. We need you to fill this out. And I said, okay. And they said, we're going to be filming a scene with Harrison Ford here in about 20 minutes, and you're going to come down and you're going to be in that scene, and you're going to have, you know, a line. And so that means that, yeah, if you have a line, that means to actor status, and you get a credit at the end of the movie, which I'm umpire five.
I love it. So did you say in this scene?
Well, in that scene, it was, you know, you're out. It was
pretty easy.
But so we, you know, I did that probably, we had about 9 or 10 takes. before.
So do you, what did you make, $5,000?
Well, the minimum SAG scale at that time was $825 a day. So you
you did get paid good.
So Will
made $64 a day.
Carrying heavy stuff, yeah.
But it was, wow. You know, that was fun. And then, when the movie was over, it goes into production and post-production. And as it turned out, one of the next great adventure was Sherry and I got to go out to Hollywood to Grauman's Chinese Theater at the world premiere of 42. And one of the interesting stories, we got to walk the red carpet, which in that situation wasn't really red. It was a black carpet with big, huge Dodger blue 42s on it.
Oh, man.
And it was exactly like what you see on TV. Everything, talk about a surreal experience.
And you try to look like you've been there before.
it
like Forrest Gump. Yeah.
It was one of the things that I did know that a lot of the listeners may find interesting was that anyone who is on the red carpet, who is walking the red carpet with the movie, they have to have an escort. Hmm. And the escort has a job. Now, as it turned out, the guy who was our escort, we were so lucky. He was one of the big wigs owning one of the movie entertainment companies in Hollywood, and he knew everyone. Mm-hmm. So there were five different photo stations on the red carpet, and each one of them had a different backdrop for mm-hmm. the photographers. And so in front of each of those photo stations, there were the big, huge group of, the mass of photographers, just as I say, just exactly like what you see on TV. And he would, position us there at the photo station. He would give our names. He would give my role. And then it just take a couple of minutes for the photographers to be shooting their pictures. Look here, look here, look here. And then I found it interesting in that when we would start to move from one station to the next, most of them would say, thank you very much. They were polite at everything. So after we progressed through the five stations, normally you go on into the theater, but he said, come with me. And so he started taking us and introducing us to the people he knew. I got to meet Dave Winfield, who is a Hall of Fame New York Yankees outfielder. Got to visit with him. We stood there and got to talk with Dave and his wife for several minutes. We had the Pittsburgh Steelers coach, who's the football analysis now, and I'm totally blanking out on his name. Got to meet him and his wife. He introduced us to a lot of different people. Then he took us over back to the beginning of the red carpet where the limos pulled up, and he said, you guys stand right here. And so we got to stand probably about 8 feet away from where the limos would pull up and the doors would open and all the stars and celebrities would get out. So we got to see the Hank Aarons and the Barry Larkins and all the other movie stars who were there for the premiere as they came in. And then we went in and watched the movie, and as we were about to go into the movie theater, he said, let me introduce you to two ladies. And they were two executives of Warner Brothers, who was the production company. It was Legendary Pictures made the movie, but Warner Brothers, they were the ones who were promoting it. And they said they had heard really my story about, the small town guy gets to go in the movies and gets to come to the red carpet. They said, we'd like for you to be able to come over with us to the after party, and gave us two tickets to the after party. So we got to go across the street, which it was at the El Capitan Hotel. And they had taken the parking lot there, and they had converted it completely into a replica as close as they could to Ebbets Field. It had the outfield scoreboard. They had put artificial turf down. They had all the different couches and chairs. It was all walled in. And in the center of it, there was a circular bar, and in the middle of that, elevated, they had brought all of Jackie Robinson's memorabilia from Cooperstown and put it there on display. So
guarded, as I might imagine. Yeah,
yeah. It was pretty spectacular. But all the stars and movie people were there. It was very casual. It was open. I was able to go up and introduce my wife Sherry to Harrison Ford, and he was just as nice as he could be. And the other people that I'd worked with, Lucas Black, and who played Pee Wee Reese, mm-hmm. and the other stars. You know, it was just an incredibly surreal evening. That, you know, who would think that on a crazy whim that, you know, you just drop something and do something spur of the moment, that it could all lead to such a great adventure.
Who was the, there was one, you know, the umpires got on the poster. Do you know who that was?
I don't remember.
Well, maybe you played a reporter there, but we met
him. I think
him.
It was a reporter.
Yeah, he was that made on the poster. I said, that'd been a good place to be on the poster.
Well, you're on the poster of one of the ones, aren't you? No, I'm a man. That must be some other celebrity.
So
I know.
We're going to open the phones here in just a moment. That was your number one film, and how many do you have total now under your belt?
Well, I've got 10 movies and 2 episodes of TV series that I've done so far.
Did you think you would ever say that?
No, I know how that sounds. I'm sitting here shaking my head laughing.
I knew he was a little skinny boy down at Bradley High School.
Yes, it does sound crazy. It still sounds crazy to me, too, to be quite honest with you.
I get a casting thing, but I haven't went on any of them because I'm waiting for the right role.
We haven't needed
anybody with my body shape and look yet. It's a problem.
How did your second adventure come about?
Well, the next adventure came about from CL Casting did the casting mm-hmm. for the extras for 42, and Rose Locke was the casting director, and she remembered me. She was just a sweet, very professional, hardworking woman, and and she liked what I did. The fact that, you know, I did everything. One of the things I guess I'm most proud of is that of everything that I have done, knock on wood as I tap my forehead, I've yet to make a mistake that has required a scene to be redone because of an error that I've made. And so, you know, I show up on time, I do what I'm told, and then I go home.
And I think that some of it is that you just look like an ordinary guy.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, he's pretty plain.
I mean, you know what I'm saying.
That's an understatement. Now, actually, I've had a several people make the comment in the industry that my looks are very flexible. In a movie that, well, Hunger Games Catching Fire was one of the movies that I worked on. In District 12, I was a hob vendor, and mm-hmm. so I let my beard grow out for 9 days before I went to the set there. I worked 5 days on it, and, you know, I looked like a black market vendor. I mean,
you said that was your second film that you worked on?
No, this one.
That was the third film
what
that
was
I
the
worked
film?
On. Let's see, they worked on Insurgent. Where I was a Kandor man, which was where everything's kind of black and white. But I was dirtied up in Hunger Games Catching Fire. I looked grubby and dirty and nasty, but I've also worked more recently in gala events with black tie. So that's one of the things that they say, well, you know, we can dress you up, or we can dress you up.
Before he tells you about his outfit for Anchorman, you're listening to Old Town Cleveland here on Whoop FM 99.9, or you can go to the internet at www.whoopfm.com. The phones are open now. You can call us here at 614-5553. We got Gary Miller here talking about his movie career. Do you have an IMD now?
Actually, Internet Movie Database, IMDb. There's a lot of Gary Millers there, but I'm Gary Miller, I think, 39, XXXIX.
All right.
On an Internet
Let's
Movie
get
Database.
This call.
Oh, is it still? Oh, there it is. Oh, wait, no. I think I flipped something wrong. Okay. Caller, you're live on Old Town Cleveland.
Yes. Good morning, Ron, Deb, and to your guy that runs the board.
This Morgan, yeah. Morgan. What's going on, buddy?
I'd just like to tell Ron a little bit about the Cleveland game last night for May.
Okay, go ahead.
Joseph Overland went in as, and he actually plays quarterback. And I don't understand why they didn't use him because he's a senior. But anyway, I was talking to Coach Ryan over last time. He invited me to walk him out of games. He found out who I was, and I'll tell you, he is a nice coach. He really is.
I'm sorry, Bullet. We're having problems with the board here this morning. Go ahead. I'm listening.
Anyway, the Cleveland game, I think they played a good game last night. But Skylar Davis won't be back for 2 weeks. I think he hurt his ankle or something.
They've had some bad luck.
Yeah, but they actually played a good game last night. And mm-hmm. I'm proud that Bradley won. But anyway, I'm going to listen to you guys. I appreciate you.
I think Skylar had a high ankle sprain last night.
Yeah, he did, but mental coach Ryan was talking about the game, and he said he don't know why they didn't start that guy's quarterback. He was named most valuable player last night.
Yeah, he apparently did a very good job against Ray County there, Ray County being a great team. So, Cleveland still has a tough road to go, so they've got if they can beat Ottawa and win out, they might be able to slip in if Walker Valley stumbles.
Well, I don't think Cleveland should. I look at the playoffs, Ron. I don't think a team should be in the playoffs if the record is bad. This is the way I feel about the playoffs.
That's the way it goes sometimes. All right, Bullet, thanks.
All right, we'll see you later.
All right, bye-bye. So you're number what number are you now? IMD?
Gary Miller, it's 39. XXXIX.
Okay.
In the search.
My name's on there. But it's not me. There's a Ron Moore who done Star Wars, so you know, a little bit bigger name than mine. So now on your second picture, I think you went just to be an extra, then someone seen you there and you got pulled on up towards the front of the scene or something.
Yeah, actually, that's, they say often it's not what you know, but who you know. That was a situation that in one of the scenes from Hunger Games Catching Fire that happened on one of the particular days. They were filming what's called the reaping scene, where they were going to do the drawing to see who was going to, from District 12, going into the competition. And there were probably 800 extras there that day for this huge scene. And so, you know, I'm there, I've got my, in that particular one, I have a black eye patch on, I'm dirtied up with my beard and just, you know, scraggly clothes and everything, and I'm kind of out in the middle of everybody, and all of a sudden I hear, Gary? And I look over and I see Ben White, who was one of the assistant directors on 42, and I walked over, and, you know, it was old home week for a couple of minutes. We'd mm-hmm. catch up, you know, what have you been doing, Ben? What have you been doing, Gary? That sort of thing. And then he, you know, looked me up and down. He said, you know, love the, you know, the eye patch, the beard. He said, and he just stopped and paused for a second. He said, come with me. And so he literally walked me up to the very front of the crowd and in front of where the scene was, where the main actress's mom and her sister and her boyfriend were, and positions me right next to the mother, or right next to actually her boyfriend, and right behind the sister, so that I would get camera time in the movie, which I did. So that was just one of those strange occurrences that you know, good Lord, smiled on me, as he has done throughout this whole process of these adventures.
If you had any more speaking roles or just?
No, everything that I have been doing is, there have been a couple of other casting companies that I've, you know, there's Tammy Smith Casting, and then there's also, Ashley Rose went out, she was partnered with CL Casting, she went out on her own with mm-hmm. Rose Lock Casting, so between those three, those are primarily the three
now,
that
see, I get
calling.
All those alerts from Rose and the other both, and like I say, just either I'm out of town or can't do it, or you know, like say you need a teenager, and I don't put the teenager part. Well, now, Morgan, I thought of you the other day. They needed like 20 teenagers down in Atlanta, and so
we were at a backlot meeting in Chattanooga last month. We were showing our little documentary from which one did we show? Ducktown. Down there. They were having a casting call for one of those.
Gang-related film
yeah,
in Chattanooga.
How to stay out of gangs kind of related movie. But Ron and I didn't quite fit in that crowd. We were just a little bit too old to be in the crowd. But now they came up very politely and watched the documentary while they were waiting to be interviewed. And they had a lot of good questions about it.
Very interesting. Said, where was this desert at? Well, it's right up here on the river.
And they just looked at us like, well, it's not there now. No, it's there. It's just it has trees and things now. But it was pretty interesting showing that to a group of people that were in their early 20s, and they had no clue.
So how much time did you spend on Hunger Games?
I worked 5 days on it.
Okay.
And with the movies since then, I've been fortunate. There's, and I learned all of this as I went along. There's different categories. There's kind of three different levels. You've got your extras, which are people that you don't know where you're going to be or if you're going to be seen or even if you're going to get invited to the set. And then you've got a featured extra. And that's really, I've been fortunate enough, that's the majority of what I have done have been featured extras. And that's where you've been selected because of your look,
You're just not a warm body.
Or you're not just a warm body. Well, a featured extra is you're selected because, for your look, and you're more likely to be in frame, in focus, where you could be recognized. And I laugh, when people say, "Well, how have you been able to work on a number of movies?" And I just said, well, whenever the casting directors were looking for someone tall, thin, old, and ugly, they said, see, Gary Miller's available.
You know, Gary Miller, number 39. Give him a call.
But it's been a lot of fun. William Wright with the Free Press, he did a really
the banner.
At the Cleveland Daily Banner, back in August, he did a really nice feature in the lifestyles and section, and in the article I was reading it, and he listed some of the stars that I've worked with, and it's when I look and read something like that I just kind of shake my head and still in disbelief. Since 2012, I've worked, and please, this is not bragging.
We know that.
This is me still shaking my head in disbelief at my how the Lord has blessed me.
Yeah.
Absolutely, but stars like Harrison Ford, Robert Duvall, Clint Eastwood, Jennifer Lawrence, Robert Downey Jr., Will Ferrell, Steve Martin, Burt Reynolds, Selena Gomez, and others.
Steve Martin. What is he like in real life?
In real life, he is just first of all, I can honestly say across the board with all of the stars that I have worked with, I have yet to work with a prima donna. They have all been as nice and genuine and as pleasant as could be. He was no exception. Doesn't act like a comedian, when in real life he just acts like a regular guy, focused. And I worked with him on a movie that's actually going to be released next month. Funny name, but it's Billy Lynn's Long Halftime Walk. The director is Ang Lee, who did Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon, and also did Life of Pi. And it's Steve Martin plays the owner of the Dallas Cowboys, and the premise of the movie is the first Iraqi war, and at that time there were a squad of soldiers who went into combat and ended up being heroes and brought back to the States to be promoted on a hero's tour. There's one scene at Cowboy Stadium on Thanksgiving Day where Steve Martin, who is the owner of the Cowboys, is hosting the heroes and having a dinner in their honor. And so my role was as a Texas aristocrat. I know, that's funny. joining him as one of his friends to meet and greet and have dinner with the soldiers. So in that scene also was Chris Tucker, the black comedian, who was a funny guy. He was very cordial. I was next to him in one of the scenes and between takes and everything. He was fun to visit with. And then also Tim Blake Nelson, who if you saw Oh Brother Where Art Thou, he was one of the three along with George Clooney and
yeah.
He was a congressman, an oil man who was there also. So, but to answer your question, you know, Steve Martin was a pleasure. And this particular movie is in 3D also, in addition to regular, but it's a new 3D technology. They'll be promoting it heavily in the weeks to come. It opens on November 11th on Veterans Day, and it's supposed to be pretty powerful.
I think we got a call here.
Alrighty, caller, you are live on Old Town Cleveland.
How you doing, Morgan?
I'm doing very well, Brett. How are you?
Good.
That's good to hear.
How you doing, Ron?
I'm doing great, Brett. How you doing, sir?
Good. We had a big win last night.
You sure did down there at Bradley.
7-0 now, right?
That's the game.
Do what?
Oh, that's the game.
Yeah, I heard you was at the game. I didn't get to talk to you, but I knew somebody who did.
I saw Dustin.
Yeah, that's who it was. So what was the score, final score there, Brett?
41-33.
That's pretty good, wasn't it?
Yeah, and we our next opponent, Ron,
mm-hmm.
they ended up winning their game, too. Harden Valley ended up winning 35-0.
Yes, sir. That's a tough matchup next week at Harden Valley.
On the road.
Yes.
Let's see if we can make it 8-0 this next game, huh?
I was gonna let you know, Ron.
Yes.
That player for Cleveland.
Yes.
Is out.
Was Skylar Davis?
Yes.
Oh, well, I'm sorry to hear that. That's about their fourth quarterback that's been hurt this year.
Yeah, what's his name? Gary Owenby told me.
Yes, yeah, well, that's sad for them, but, you know, they played pretty good last night for even being on their fifth-string quarterback.
And they ended up losing that game 35-28.
That's right, one touchdown.
And Meekman County ended up winning their game, too.
Beating the number one team in the state, Oak Ridge.
28-24.
That's a big, big win for Meekman County.
Yeah, Tennessee plays their game today, too.
Yes.
They will play at 3:30.
All right. So who's going to win that ball game today?
I'm going with Tennessee.
What's the score?
35-14.
That's what I thought it might be, 35-14. Yeah, well, we hope you're right.
All right.
All right, well, thank you, Brett.
All right, you too. Bye-bye.
Brett's our roving Whoop sports reporter for us. He has to give us the scores there every week. So after Hunger Games, and you went on to Anchorman?
Mm-hmm. Anchorman 2.
Of course, you sit in one of the main newsroom scenes. You're right in the middle behind, you know, Will Ferrell there. And it was that outfit you had on that I thought was most interesting. But then I found out that was your own personal outfit. I mean, where do you come up with, what was it, yellow pants and green and white check pants, or what? Describe that outfit for me again.
It was back in 1976. When I was going to UTC, I also worked at a men's clothing store, and I had bought a bright yellow solid Jack Nicklaus blazer. I had the old plaid Sansa belt pants that went with it, and also had some white shoes. And so when I was invited to...
You bought that on purpose, right?
At that time, that was high fashion.
That wasn't Halloween or nothing. No, that was just in regular clothes.
Actually, I had kept it in the back of my closet, and I've worn it a couple of times at primarily like for just as a joke for parties. You know, a couple of parties and everything. And so when I was invited to come down to do wardrobe for Anchorman 2, I said, well, yeah, I may have something that might work. because I think that was set in 79 or early 80s in Anchorman 2. And when I got there, all the wardrobe people were there, and the main wardrobe lady was there, and I had everything in a bag, the garment bag, and I said, I have something that might work. And, you know, she did everything but roll her eyes. She said, okay, yeah, go ahead and try it on. We'll take a look at it. And so
Now, Morgan, this was bulletproof polyester from the 1970s.
Yellow.
The real deal.
Yellow.
Yellow.
So I put it on, and I came walking out, and she just froze. She walked over. She looked at me from head to toe, and she just freaked. She called all the other wardrobe people over. She said, this is perfect. She said, everybody look at this. This is what we're looking for the people to look like. And she said, the jacket looks brand new. And, you know, the pants, you know, she was, you know, touching the fabric and everything. I said, well, you know, it's polyester. I mean, it'll look like this 100 years from now.
Can't tear this stuff up.
And so anyway, so I ended up, you know, actually wearing my own clothes in Anchorman 2.
What makes me mad
at the same time.
You know what makes me mad about that is that after all those years, you still wear the same clothes you did in 76. I went through like eight different sizes.
Well, that was one of the things a couple of the other wardrobe people said. They said, you've had this, you wore this in 76, and then they were looking at it, and I said, yeah, and they said, well, we're impressed that you can still get into it. And I just laughed, and I said, well, again, you know, tall, thin, old, and ugly. So,
yeah.
But it was Will Ferrell. It was interesting. I had a scene just with Will Ferrell that did not make the cut. It ended up on the cutting room floor, but with just the two of us. And it was interesting. I really got to see the type of person he was, which was a really nice guy. When he came walking up, you know, I'm sitting there. They positioned me on the set with the cameras, and he walks up and he introduces himself, like, you know, okay, I wouldn't know who he was.
Yeah.
And then, you know, we did all the scene and everything. And then when we got finished, rather than just walk off, you know, he stopped and he shook my hand and said, you know, I appreciate you working with me today. And so, you know, that really showed me the character, you know, that he had. And I've had similar situations.
He was trying to get your yellow blazer off that.
Well, actually, between takes, we were both laughing about it. And he said, you know, you look like a professional golfer. And I just laughed when he said, no, he said, really, he said, you look like a professional golfer. And I said, well, actually, these pants, I did in the late 70s, I did see Johnny Miller on TV wearing this exact pair of Sam's Belt slacks, and we just both laughed and everything. But
now, is he as tall as he's a tall guy, isn't he?
Yeah, he's
Ferrell.
I'm guessing he's 6'3", maybe.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, but he's a little shorter than you.
No, he's about maybe 2 inches tall. I'm 6'1". He's become maybe a couple of inches taller than me. But it's been nice as far as the actors that I've worked with and how nice they've been. I worked on with Clint Eastwood back earlier this year or at last year.
What was that like?
How do you not be starstruck? That was fun. He was the director. Actually, it was on Sully. The movie that just came out last month.
Oh,
and I was in a flashback scene of 1967 when Sullenberger was a 16-year-old learning how to fly. So there were none of the stars that were in that scene.
Could you wear that yellow jacket again?
I did not, but I did have some really nifty looking coveralls. I was an airplane mechanic, but it was fun and had. We were eating and we were finished for the day. We actually wrapped, and so, you know, we had, you know, had dinner before we were taking off. And as I was walking out, Clint Eastwood said, you know, thank you for the
job. Now, was he directing?
He was the director. And so, you know, got to take direction from him and, you know, got to meet him. And there have been several others. I was working on another movie that will probably be released next year, which is called In Dubious Battle. And it's based on John Steinbeck novel. You know, you've heard of The Grapes of Wrath. Well,
right.
It's in that trilogy of the three books set in the early 30s in the apple orchards of California when they're... organizers are coming in to unionize the workers, and I'm one of the apple pickers. And in that movie, there were a lot of stars there. James Franco starred and directed it, and Selena Gomez, you know, got to meet her, work some scenes with her and a number of others. But the reason I really wanted to work on that movie was because Robert Duvall was in that, and I got to be in a couple of scenes with Robert Duvall,
oh, yeah,
who was
great.
One of my all-time favorite actors. And the neatest part of working with him came when we were between takes and there were just a few of us standing around. We're waiting for them to reset the cameras. And he was in a good mood, and he's just such a fine gentleman, just such a fine, fine man, but an amazing actor. But he started telling us stories about The Godfather, about some behind-the-scenes stories, funny stories, and of course, The Godfather. I guess it's probably my number one all-time favorite.
Yeah,
I can't imagine.
And again, talk about surreal experiences.
That's my pay for the day.
Yeah, that's the reason that I enjoy doing this. You know, if I get some time, FaceTime when the movie comes out.
Mm-hmm.
That's just icing on the cake. I ended up on the cutting room floor.
Well, we sympathize with that. Just making these little documentaries, we will sit and talk for 45 minutes about 40 seconds worth of documentation because you think, okay, well, that's really good. I hate not to. So I can't imagine doing a whole big movie. I just can't imagine.
Well, in retrospect, after seeing the movie and the scene that we filmed, it was a good edit.
Okay. Sometimes you think something's going to fit and it doesn't. You know.
Yeah. No. They of the scene that I worked in, they only used about 60 seconds in the movie, and it fit. But if they had tried to use the scene that I was in, it would have not worked.
Right. It would just been fluffy or something.
Yeah.
But it is really hard to decide. And so on a major movie, I can't imagine.
For the people who've never been at a movie set or had the opportunity, you go in and in 5 minutes you're done for the day, right?
You have to be very patient.
Or should I say there's a lot of time you sit around and wait.
I went, let me just tell you about the latest. I can't give a lot of detail because of the confidentiality agreement, but the week before last, I was in Atlanta. I did I call them a one and done, one day, but I pulled out of my driveway at 2 a.m., had to be on the set ready at 4:30 a.m., and they cut us loose that night at 8 p.m. So that was the day. And so you go in, you fill out your paperwork to start with when you get there, then you go through wardrobe, then you go to hair and makeup, and then you wait for them to call you to the set. And fortunately, on this particular day, I was on the set the majority of the day, but yeah, if you're not on the set, there's a holding area, which is typically just a nice area with tables and chairs, and so, you know, you can sit and visit with people, or, you know, you can get on your phone and, you know, check emails or, you know, that sort of thing. So
they're really particular about those phones on set, aren't they?
On the set, you do not bring a phone or have a phone out on the set. You know, in the holding area, it's okay, but on the set, I have seen people literally escorted off the set, and that was on Insurgent. There was a young guy there who actually took a picture, and they saw it, and they brought security in, and he was taken off property. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, they're very serious about keeping the confidentiality of the movies.
Probably the worst thing you could be doing while you're on the set is be roaming around, just walking around and walk out onto and be in the back of the photobomb a shot. It doesn't go too big either, does it?
If you do that, you would only do it once.
Yes.
Now, do they tell you how not to look at the camera when you're supposed to just be? I mean, do they say don't look at the camera or?
No, they really don't. They expect you just to know that, and that's a good question.
Because if you're in the background, you have to be careful that you're not watching what's going on up there. I think that would be really hard.
What's really interesting in terms of...
get closer to your microphone.
Oh, sorry. Bringing up, like, looking at the camera, the actor who played... I forgot his name. The actor who played Daredevil in the Netflix series, he was basically told, don't look at the camera, and the context was because Daredevil's character's blonde. Mm-hmm. Well, he auditioned for another movie, and he almost got the part, but he was so used to the Daredevil role
that
he was
just looking the wrong way.
Look anywhere because he was so used to being playing a blind guy.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I think would be really, if I saw Harrison Ford standing over there talking, I would have a real hard time not watching him. So
well, if you're off camera, it's okay. But they do say, you know, don't stare at the actors. You know, they're real people too. Mm-hmm. They're regular people too. And so don't make them uncomfortable. So you know that they say don't be that guy.
Will, instead of 42, he was back helping. One day he took around one of the big contributors to the movie, financial contributors. He took the family around, make sure they got stuff. He'd done that kind of stuff. And then he was back eating one day, and he sat there and helped us. Both guys went for the same role and hit each other. He turned around looking at Branch Rickey,
it's Harrison Ford.
Well, that's Harrison Ford. That's who he's playing.
Oh, okay.
And he was in his Branch Rickey. And so they're fighting over a role and just laughing and having a good time.
Yeah. And then Will didn't recognize him at first because he had on that fat suit, you know.
Right.
Yeah. And then all of a sudden he thought, oh my gosh, I'm standing here laughing and talking to Harrison Ford.
Well, the thing about what I'm doing is that I never know if I'll get another opportunity. So every time that I go out to work on a project, I just make the assumption that this is my last, you know, great adventure. And so I'm really blessed that my wife and my family have been so supportive. My friends, you know, they seem to enjoy, you know, asking questions and hearing kind of the backstories like this. So I want to thank, you know, both you and Ron for inviting me to join you today. It's been a lot of fun catching up with you before the show again
and
hearing all of your adventures and travels and good things coming up. So
you said you were with Burt Reynolds. Was that the one that filmed in Knoxville?
Dog Years.
Dog Years, yes.
And, Burt's showing the effects of all of it, the stunt he did. And,
yeah.
You know, he had to have some assistance, but the sense of humor was still there. He's an older guy. He's in his 80s now.
But yeah.
The twinkle in his eye and and his sense of humor, it's still there.
Ron, well, we need to take our mid-mortem break here. Are you ready, Morgan?
I've got everything set up.
All right. Hey, we'll be back here in a few minutes, and we only play a song called Gone Home for all those people who have passed in our community. This is an honor of them. Thank you. And we'll be back in a few minutes.
Hello. I'm the doctor.
And you're listening to WOOPLP, Cleveland, Tennessee. Whoop FM is a broadcasting service of the Traditional Music Resource Center, and we play America's original music.
Check into cash. The cash you need today is waiting for you at Check Into Cash. It's your money, so come in and get it.
Get a payday advance today for up to $425. At Check Into Cash, we make it quick, easy, and confidential.
The cash you need is right here, so stop worrying and stop in to Check Into Cash today.
Borrowers often use payday advances over a period of months, which can be expensive. Restrictions apply. See store for details.
No dealers allowed.
Jackson Kettnapper, family owned and operated in Cleveland since 1933, offering the best with over 70 styles of recliners, sofas, electronic lift chairs, full living room packages. Call Mike now at 961-7239 because Jackson Kettnapper now offers sales to the public
every Saturday. That's right, every Saturday.
From 8 in the morning to 1 in the afternoon. Or call Mike at 961-7239. Or go see him
every Saturday
at 1911 King Edward Avenue, just across from the main plant. Jackson Kettnapper, family owned and operated in Cleveland since 1933. 961-7239.
No dealers allowed.
All of my say, gone home,
gone home,
gone home,
gone home, home.
They've joined the heaven before.
They're walking the streets of here gone. They left one by one as the work here was done.
Gone home.
Welcome back to Old Town Cleveland here on Whoop FM 99.9, or you can go to the internet at www.whoopfm.com. You can call us here at 614-5553. Got a good friend of ours, Gary Miller, here, who's an ongoing movie star up for an Oscar this year, I believe.
That would be a stretch by anyone's definition.
Well, compared to most of us, you've been in more movies mm-hmm. than most of the people here in Bradley County, I would say.
He's a professional extra.
Gary's a graduate of Bradley High School in 1971. Good to see a fellow bear in here this morning. And a few things going on. If tomorrow at 2:30 at the
public library.
Yeah, that's that place. The public library in the community room.
That big building.
Yeah, the Bradley County Historical and Genealogical Society will be hosting their quarterly meeting, and their guest speaker is Gary Ormby, who will do a preview of his new book, 100 Years of Football at Bradley Central High School.
The photographs are incredible.
Oh, it is.
You will want to come see those.
I did the PowerPoint presentation for him. I put it together the other day. And photos that I've never seen before, which I were just, I'm going, oh, I'm glad I got copies of them now, too. I kept a copy. They're really great. So, and if you're into history or into genealogy, I can't say that word.
Genealogy.
Thank you. I can't say much this morning for some reason. You know, I'll guarantee that they're going to talk about some of your family and some of the your relatives from this community, because there's literally thousands of
people. I think one thing he likes to talk about in the book is, he calls it the gene pool, where you have people out of families that everybody was an athlete in the family for even more than one generation, which I think is really interesting.
And we've got one currently right now in the Copeland family. Mm-hmm.
There's three brothers that played quarterback, and then their son, Brian's son, Bryce, and now Cole Copeland, who's a signee at UTC, have been quarterbacks there, and their daughter's playing at Florida basketball. So, you know, Brooke's doing all right, too. So you're going, it's a big family, but there's several other families, the Center families and the Johnsons, and, of course, you know, you go back to the Scott.
I think if you're just interested in history and like to see it, I think he has some school pictures in there, too.
He does have a very early picture of, I know, Bradley High School. He had very early pictures of the Bradley High School football team, like 1916 football team, which is the first year.
So I know we had one of those old pictures, and they had a homemade goalpost that was
two befores,
and they were sagging in the center. I wanted to mention too that along with the society meeting tomorrow at 2:30, Prater's Mill's going on this weekend, today and tomorrow. The quilt show is going on out at Mount Olive Church of God today. I think it'll probably end early this afternoon. Next week, we're going to have our Apple Festival in downtown Cleveland. Pumpkin Town Celebration is today in Athens, and the Antique Tractor Show is going on at Charleston City Park until 3 p.m. today. Ron, before we get started.
Cleveland State, you forgot to mention what's going on at Cleveland State.
The Geeksters.
Today. The Geeksters are there.
So that's the folks that are interested in the old toys, games, comic books, all those things. Go up there.
Morgan's interested.
I believe it's like $5 to go through. And then last year they had so many vendors they had to turn people away. So it's turned into a really big deal. Also, Ron, take a few minutes and tell us about the dedication that you attended in Charleston Thursday.
Right. For many years, the Fort Cass, or since 1938. Fort Cass was where all the orders... 1838. All the orders for all Cherokees to be removed from this part of the country, not only just Bradley County and Tennessee, but Georgia, Alabama, anywhere that they were Indians being sent on the Trail of Tears to Oklahoma, those orders come from a little community called Fort Cass, which is Charleston, Tennessee. It was basically a compound of 4 miles wide, 12 miles long, coming towards Cleveland, and there was up to 17,000 Cherokee Indians in there, and almost...
moved through there, yeah.
So the National Park Service now has recognized Fort Cass. There's a sign there that says, you are now at Fort Cass, you are 0 miles on the Trail of Tears. Mm-hmm. As Deb will tell you, if you go out going towards Oklahoma, you'd run into where the Trail of Tears says, you're 700 miles from Fort Cass, you're 400 miles from Fort Cass. Mm-hmm. There's no sign that said Fort Cass anywhere. It does now that. There's a new walking tour that'll have beautiful panels up. It'll explain the plight of the Cherokee Indians. It'll go over towards the river through the Cypress Gardens.
Did you know, Gary, that there's Cypress Gardens in Charleston, Tennessee?
I had no idea.
Well, they have cleaned it up and go to the Henniger House, the old red brick house there on Broadway, I think, at the Springs anyway. And just south of the Springs is the Cypress Gardens. And the TVA, when TVA took over, they planted the cypress trees to help with flooding. Somewhere along the way, they had a giant fire in there, and TVA came back in and replanted them. Of course, they're probably 30 or 40 years old now. I don't know the trees are. But that's one of the things that the trail's going to walk right by the Cypress Gardens, and they've planted a natural Indian flower bed garden thing there. And so you'll be able to leave the Heritage Center close to the football field at Charleston High School, walk down
to the Hiawassee River.
To the Hiawassee River. And follow these panels, and that's step number one. But the National Park Service arrived, and Jonathan Cantrell's participation in this project is outstanding.
He's actually going to give
Caldwell Paving.
Caldwell Paving is going to volunteer to do the work on the trail itself, and there was other money for it's an amazing project. The National Trail of Tears and the National Park Service is now recognized Charleston, Tennessee. Which is a big thing. What we look for now is the big brown signs out on the interstate says, welcome to Fort Cass.
Yeah, so, get off here, yeah. Yes. We're just really excited about it, and Ron got to go to the dedication there on Thursday, and it was a big deal. And I think Troy Petit, who's been a guest on our show a couple times. That's a Supreme Court Justice for the Cherokee Nation. Every time he's coming out this way, he lets us know so we can put him on the show. I think he was in tears talking about it Thursday.
And Jack Baker, the president, a councilman of the Cherokee Nation, was also there, and president of the National Trail of Tears, said that there's 350,000 full-blood Cherokees now in the country.
Recognized Cherokees.
Yeah, and he said that most of them can trace their ancestors back to Charleston, Tennessee, leaving on the Trail of Tears. That's
it's going to be
impressive.
Very meaningful thing for them to come back. Anyway, I wanted to mention that, and there's great things going on in Charleston. They're going to build on to their building and start the trail, and of course, we'll keep you guys updated on that. I thought of something I was going to ask Gary, and now it has left me.
You can call here at 614-5553. If you'd like to call Gary and him give you movie, he'll give you critiques on movies. He'll give you critiques on how you can get into the film industry. It's a 10% commission, though, for every time that you get a job, you know. And he'll be glad to tell you.
Ron will appreciate this. Doc Hollywood's online. Our friend Doc Hollywood that does the disco show here on Saturday nights. Yeah. But he says he's taking the night off to watch the football. But he said if there's any movies out there where they're making a disco movie, he's got the suits, the records, and the disco ball.
He missed it because it was one not too long ago. I'd seen that down in Atlanta. There was actually one that they
did a disco
show.
Our products, by the way, for Old Town Productions that are available, most of them are available at the Museum Center at Five Points. They finally figured out if they put them out, somebody'd buy them. So if you would like to pick up any of our DVDs, and some of our books are down there, you can go by the Museum Center. But, Gary, you've started an online market. Yeah, explain that to us.
Well, it's my daughters, Sarah and Rachel, and you know, they came to Dad, you know, with a good idea, and I said, "Yeah, that is a good idea." So I'll see if I can help you with it. But Sarah and Rachel both have, you know, they're very artistic, and Sarah does a lot of craft work and goes to the markets, the fairs, and you know, sells products and everything. And she's very talented, and you know, so is Rachel. But she was saying, "Yeah, I'm." Might like to have a website to be able to sell my things. And she said, you know, there's some marketplaces where you can open a shop on them, mm-hmm. and where a lot of shops are, and you can sell them. And one of them was Etsy, E-T-S-Y. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, that sounds good. I looked at it, and I said, well, why not have something similar to Etsy where you can open your shop and your friends can do the same sort of thing. And so I really spent some significant time doing the research on that, mm-hmm. and looking at the different business models of the online marketplace venue. So I guess to describe what I'm talking about, if you can imagine, say, Hamilton Place Mall. And so you have someone who creates the mall, and then you have all the different stores who come in and open up, and they sell your products. So you have someone who owns the mall. Well, that's what we've created, you know, with, you know, Sarah and Rachel, and it's called OurVillage.com, 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 like it takes a village. And so people who have products to sell can open a shop and are able to have access on the Internet. It's a lot easier than creating their own website. Mm-hmm. They have more visibility. But one of the things that we wanted to do differently was wanted to have something with a social consciousness, mm-hmm. is that, you know, it's not just a money-making venture, but we want to do something good that does good for people. And both of the girls had previously worked earlier as volunteers for Room in the Inn, mm-hmm. in Chattanooga, which provides services to battered or homeless women and their families. So we made the decision that we were going to put part of the gross proceeds that would be earned by our village, contributing that, you know, to starting out with Room in the Inn. And as it grows, we'll be selecting other organizations who will be making contributions to. So in looking at the competition, quote-unquote, with the other websites, such as an Etsy, On those sites, if you want to open a store, open a shop there, for every item that you list, the photo and the description and the price that you sell, there's a 20-cent listing fee. And then also on all of your sales, there's a 3.5% commission that's deducted from your sales. And we looked at, we looked at that and said, there's got to be a better way. You know, the sellers out there, the artists and the craftsmen and artisans, they work so hard for their money, and it doesn't seem right to take part of their money, for us. So we came up with a model where the shop owners get to keep 100% of it. It's just a flat $5 fee per month to have your shop on our village, mm-hmm. period. And out of that $5, 20% of that goes to Room in the Inn in Chattanooga. And as we grow, we'll be selecting other organizations in other cities across the country that do similar work that would be receiving funding. So it's in startup phase right now. I think there's about 20 shops that are on there. But I'm really proud of the girls. That they've got good hearts. They want to do something that is going to be good for the communities, and what better cause than to be able to help the women and their families who are going through the just unimaginable crises in their lives, and helping these organizations that help them get their life back together and be able to take care of their families.
So if people want to shop for crafts or whatever products go on here, they just go to ourvillage.com and click on a seller and just buy directly from them, right?
That's exactly right. They buy directly through PayPal. They buy directly, and then the shop owner sells their products. I actually have a niece, a great niece out in Oklahoma. She's in Nashville now, Kylie Morgan. She's actually has moved to Nashville and has a contract, a songwriting contract with one of the big recording companies in Nashville. And one of the things that she does is she customizes boots, ladies' boots, and she calls it Hippie Kicker Boots that's on the site. Mm-hmm. And so she puts them on there and sells them from the site, beautiful boots. And so you go, click on, order it through PayPal, buy it, and then she ships it out.
Okay, that's why we do off of our web.
Let me ask you a tough question here, is that this is like the chicken and the egg, isn't it? Is the more sellers you got on there, more people come to it. But you got to have people come to it before the sellers are interested, right? It's sort of a chicken and egg type thing, isn't it?
It is, right? And right now, you're exactly right, Ron. That's one of the things when you're first starting out with a new venture like this is, you need to have sellers so that when people come there, they have a selection. And then you have to find a way for people to know that it's there so that the buyers will come to it. So what we've done right now, through the end of the year, anyone who opens a shop on our village, there's not even the $5 a month fee.
Sign us up, Ron.
I think we have, matter of fact. I'm not sure. I think I did that.
No, I don't think so.
I think we were going to.
We talked about it.
There's a lot of things in my life that I'm going to do. Okay. I know what I'm doing this afternoon before the ball game.
But one of the things that in any starting up any companies, I know the importance of putting together a team of the right people to support. So we've got our village is majority woman owned with my two daughters, but I've put together a tech team and also put together a social media team. So we've got some really quality people who are making it very user friendly for the seller to be able to come and open their shop and make it easier for the buyer as far as, the minimum number of clicks and screens that they have to go through. And right now the social media team's going through the process of putting together the plan to get the word out on a national scale about the company and what we're doing.
I think our products would help you because it would be people Googling a specific thing if it just gets to your website, when they're talking about Copper Hill or Dirt Track Racing or something like that. Because, people are still finding our website and ordering all the time, and we haven't updated the website in a long time because
it's making money. Why touch it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, well, exactly. And that's one of the nice things. I know, you know, before we came on air, you were telling me about.
We've had some really nice sales. People really love history. I love it.
So all of our listeners out there, go to ourvillage.com and look around. And if you happen to be a craftsman or sell something, you know, I guess there are certain rules there. You can't sell everything, but, you know, right, there'd be some rules. But if you make, you know, boots, or you make pocketbooks, or
artists or
authors, if you're going to sell your books, or if you have a lot of books,
yeah, that's really reasonable.
That'd be a great place to go for $5 a month. That is really dirt cheap.
With the research, there is no other more cost-effective avenue for selling products for the craftsmen, the artists, the people who want to sell it. If you go out to a craft fair, unless it's, you know, free, you know, you're paying a booth fee. If you have your own website, you have a hosting fee, you have the time that's involved in it. So this is kind of the best solution for the least
amount
of money.
And I think it's real current, too. A few years ago, everyone expected you to have a big, huge website, and now they're just kind of use stuff like Facebook and then a simpler website to sell things on.
Yes. So please go look at that, ourvillage.com. Mm-hmm. Sounds a great idea, particularly if you're a craftsman or craft lady in the area. They would more people on there looking, and more people on there buying, and more people on there listing, and that's the way it happens. It starts new. So it's chicken and egg. You got to have them both this time, right?
That's exactly right.
That's great. So we've talked about, you've been in Hunger Games. You was in 42.
TV shows did you do?
In July, there was an episode of Devious Maids that was on. It's a Lifetime Network episode, and they were having a gala black tie event and sort of a silent auction, and they had, that was a lot of fun. That was a one and done. That was a one day down there, did the work and came back, and I got screen time there. I was in the background behind a couple of different scenes and everything. So then the last one was the one I was just talking about earlier a couple of weeks ago. I still can't give the name right of it, but it was, I can say the director was Mario Van Peebles.
Famous
black actor, and he was funny. He was very nice, mm-hmm, nice too. There was one of the.
He was in Heartbreak Ridge with Clint Eastwood, wasn't he? Not.
And a number of other
movies,
but we were sitting around a table. You know, it was supposed to be a dinner, and of course it's black tie, and he walks up and puts his hand on the lady's shoulder next to me and said, "Let me tell you about the specials that we have tonight," as if he were the waiter when we were waiting between the scenes. You know, of course, everybody cracks up, but, you know, that's the kind of thing that makes it fun.
Absolutely.
It makes it really fun to work.
I know our son got to go to be on Nashville, and he was the stage director pointing at lights, and there, you know, the people are in front of him, the actors are in front of him, so he's point for 2 or 3 seconds. Then his elbow was in one scene, and his black tennis shoe, we saw it too. So that was his whole all day. But he said, you know, they're sitting around, they're waiting, you know, for anything. And he's sitting with the part of the crew that's not in the next set. And he's sitting there, and all the guitar pickers were sitting there and around together. My son's a guitar picker and loves the Eagles, all that. And this guy's sitting there, and this guy keeps talking about it. He said, "Yeah, Don and I wrote that song." And then he said, "Then Glenn," he says, "Your name's Souter?" He says, "You were one of the original guitar players for the Eagles." He said, "Yes."
My dad,
he says, I had to remember not to act or anything. He's sitting there, and he said, "Are you an Eagle fan?" He goes, "Uh-huh." Yeah. But he says, right, you know, he got to meet this guy. Was, you know, he's just an Eagle, total Eagle fan, you know, everything going. Here's this guy sitting there talking about Don Henley and Glenn Frey. He said, and then, you know, the Deacon, the guy, one of the main guitar players in there, they're sitting there around picking. He's just going, "Oh, this is great." I just sit there and was real quiet.
All right, let's get this caller. Caller, you're live on Old Time Cleveland.
Good morning. This is Marilyn.
Hey, Marilyn.
What's up?
Well, I'm enjoying this, hearing all this young man's adventures. And I heard you talking about the Historical Society meeting tomorrow. Well, we go to church with Data Caldwell. I can't wait to get there in the morning and go, you're going to be...
you're part of history today.
At the Historical Society meeting. I'm sure you'll be impressed with that.
Well, and if anyone has not picked up that basketball book, I think he only has a few of them left, and I'm not sure that he's going to reprint them. I don't know that for sure.
All the proceeds of both of his books went to Bradley High School. So that's just another thing. And they got sponsors to pay for the printing, so 100% of it's going back to the Bradley High School programs down there. So that's a good thing, too, that Gary's done.
Yeah, well, that's real good. And Mr. T said to remind you that he has a fish truck coming October the 29th at 11 o'clock at the Southeastern Farmers Co-op. I think we need to pray for rain before.
Hard to put fish in those ponds when there ain't no water.
It's a hard matter to keep them fish alive without water.
Right.
Unbelievably dry. I've never seen it like this.
This is fish from the Arkansas Pond Stalkers.
That's right.
That sounds like a good bluegrass band, doesn't it?
It sing songs about fish, going fishing. Yep. Well, I'm enjoying the program.
Thank you.
We'll talk to you later. Thank you.
Thank you.
Real quick, Gary, before we get back into the movies, tell us who your mom and dad was here in this community.
It's Virgil and Sarah Miller. Ashley lived out on Georgetown Road, and they attended Clinging Ridge Baptist Church for many, many years. Some of your listeners might know my sister, Janice Baker, still lives here. She was actually talking about the Bradley Barretts. Janice was one of the
managers. She worked at Arch Chemical or Olin Chemical.
Yeah, she's coming back from Switzerland today, flying back. She's HR director and
yes.
over there for some meetings. But, my mom and dad... my dad unfortunately passed in 07 and he was always a big baseball, big Braves fan, so unfortunately he wasn't able to listen to me about that, but my mom passed in July, and so she was able to participate as far as, you know, she enjoyed hearing about my adventures and going to some of the movies and everything, so it's that's what I probably enjoy the most about it. The adventure is nice and the experience is nice, but I've had so much support and enjoyment by my family, you know, with Sherry and Sarah and Rachel and my granddaughter Daisy and, you know, my friends who know me and realize that how I don't pat myself on the back by any stretch of the imagination. I'm as wide-eyed every time I go on a new adventure as anyone, and realize just how fortunate and how blessed that I've been to do this. But anyway,
you ain't got you a smoking jacket yet or anything?
Nothing like that. Okay. No.
Well, so what other movies have you been in? Now we've mentioned Hunger Games and 42, Sully. And you talked about Dog Ears a little bit.
Dog Ears. Earlier this year, I've worked on, was in Captain America, Civil War. I worked with Robert Downey Jr.
That's good.
And the scene, I was an MIT alumni in that movie. There's a movie, The Phenom, with Paul Giamatti that has not been released, and actually that was a one and done. I went down to Atlanta and worked one evening as a baseball, another home plate umpire,
mm-hmm.
As a baseball umpire. So, you know, it's, again, just kind of the surreal aspect, but it's really fun. Of everything is different. Every set is different. You know, typically the people are different. And the thing about the actors that it's kind of surprising, and then in a way it's not, is that they typically are just regular people. And if you treat them like regular people, they respond to that. You know, I've seen some people that, you know, act all, you know, the starstruck and that sort of thing. And they're just ordinary people with extraordinary talents in extraordinary situations.
Well, it's like walking up to Robert Duvall and not being a little bit going like, oh, gosh, you know, Robert Duvall in Godfather, and he's telling you Godfather stories. And what was the movie he'd done, The Prophet?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought that was one of his greatest.
And The Judge.
The Judge. Of course, that was a good one, too, lately.
And then, and I'm blanking out the Western series. Help me here. Can't believe that neither of us.
Unforgiven?
No, the Lonesome Dove.
Lonesome Dove, okay.
Yes, Lonesome Dove. I mean, God.
I usually, 4 hours later, standing in line at CVS, I'll scream out somebody's name because it's finally come to me.
Yeah, that's great. But, you know, it's hard, you know, it'd be hard not to do that. But so on these sets, you know, it's a lot of waiting. You know, sometime you're busy, sometime you sit and wait, and in the back room or completely off the set. Who is the hardest person to get along on the set? There always got to be somebody that just seems like that they're the person. Is it the...
Or it's a job.
The assistant director, I mean, because he's the one that's going to get crapped on every time something goes wrong.
Well, the assistant directors probably have the most pressure on them,
mm-hmm.
because they're responsible for, you know, and the PAs, the production assistants. Those mm-hmm. are the two that have the most pressure on them because they're responsible for coordinating, having people in the right places, doing the right things. So they're very focused. And, you know, usually there's a lot of instruction of, okay, here's what we're going to do when we go back in, if we're in holding. So when we go in, we need you to do this. We need you to do that. Here, you know, to be positioned. Or when you go in, the assistant director, the AD is going to be there to show you, you know, where to be positioned and what to do, tell you what to do. So during the downtime, there's a lot of visiting with, you know, with the others mm-hmm. there. I've made some really, you know, great friends over the past few years that I, you know, keep in touch with, you know, from this. But at the same time, you're there to do a job. You know, it's mm-hmm. not, it's not all fun and games. It is fun and games, but you're there to do a job. You know, it's serious business. These people, this is the way they earn their living. So you have to look at it that way. So when you go to the set, mm-hmm. you know, you're there, you know, at that point, you're on the clock and you're doing what you're supposed to be doing. So you get it right the first time and they can move on to the next scene, because in that business, time is big money.
I don't mean to give you whiplash here, but what was your first job ever?
Ever?
That you got paid for?
Oh, golly, I started working so young.
See, Ron started at 12.
Yeah. Yeah. I worked on the farm first and everything. And then my grandfather, Grandpa Hinkle, was custodian at Hopewell School. And so I worked after school and during the summers at Hopewell, stripping floors and sweeping and mopping and starting the boiler in the mornings and all that kind of thing.
Real work.
Yeah. Real work.
But I probably Brown Stove Works, I guess, may have been my first real job.
Where you filled out an application and got a job.
Went in and you had the assembly line
mm-hmm.
and where the stoves were made, and then it went over the street on the conveyor belt down into the shipping area. And then there was the end of the line where the... And I was at the end of the line.
Lifting.
I had the you know, the hand truck where you would take it and you would go put them in line, and, you know, by model numbers, and then when it was time, you know, you would load the trucks and that sort of thing. So yeah,
that's called motivation to go to college.
At the end of 8 hours, you had worked, right? You were tired.
Yes, that was the real world. Of course, most of the jobs that I worked were real world jobs. That, you know, I never had any of the cushy thing. You know, it was physical labor, and made me really appreciate the opportunities that I had to get an education and do mm-hmm. things, you know, that I enjoyed more.
Mm-hmm. Ron used to unload big chunks of foam rubber off of boxcars in the summer.
Now, you think foam rubber would be light, but we're talking about a piece of foam rubber that is a huge, no, it's bigger than a mattress. It was huge. It took like four or five people to pick it up and carry it. If it fell on you, you hope the other guys could get it off because, you know, it just trap you, you know. If there's some young people listening, you know, of course, not a lot of young people listen to our show. This is predominantly a little bit older market that listens to Old Town Cleveland, but
Have faithful listeners that listen every week.
If somebody wanted to be in there, I mean, do they need to get pictures made and have a bio written, or what do they need to do to even start? You know, it's not in the paper every day that, hey, they're going to be a movie tomorrow.
It's a common misconception that, you know, you need to have really high-end photos, you know, made, and a portfolio and all of that. No, if there's someone out there who might be interested in you know, trying to get cast as an extra or a featured extra or anything, I would tell them to go to some of the extras casting websites like ACL Casting or Rose Law Casting or Tammy Smith Casting. And you can go in there and you can actually do a submission there, which you fill out all of your personal data as far as, you know, contact information, all the sizes of your clothing, height, weight, that sort of thing. And they typically want three photos, which can be just the photos should be taken one headshot, one shot profile, and then one full-length shot. No other people in the photo, and this is something interesting, too. If you're looking to work in movies or on TV, you're a little bit better not to be smiling in the photos. But if you're looking to do print work, smiling photos get you more work.
Interesting. Very interesting.
I think about being a hand model.
That might have worked pretty good until you broke that finger.
So that's really all it is. You know, submit that to them, get in their database, and then you know they'll and watch for the, you know, they'll have casting calls, and they'll either reach out to you because you're in their database, or if you see something that really looks interesting and you fit, and they'll give very detailed descriptions. Ron, you were talking about earlier where, you know, they're looking for teenagers that may have some special athletic abilities, or, you know, that they're very specific on the type of people they're looking for.
Former DJs, you know, DJs or policemen or funeral operators. You know, if you've ever been associated, just like you was an umpire, that you already have that feel for that, and don't expect to get a speaking part first time like you did. And, you know, you said he was out. That was your whole speaking line, right?
On that one scene with Harrison Ford that didn't. I had some other, but in the movie, but
and the pay is not absolutely great. I mean, you got a good amount of pay, but you're talking, you know, $6,400 for 8 hours work. Is a lot of time what Rose Casting, what it is, you know, like you're going to be there for 8 hours and they're going to pay you
$64. I'd say if you're going for the money, you're going for the wrong reason. Yeah. This should be considered a hobby.
Well, my wife laughs when she tells her friends, some husbands' hobbies are hunting or fishing or golfing or tennis. She said, mine goes and plays make-believe a day or two occasionally.
Well, I play make-believe when I play golf, too.
But the difference is that, you know, when I come back, I've made money as opposed to spending it and everything. So, yeah, you're not going to get rich if you're doing it for the money, then you're doing it for the wrong reason.
Well, a lot of the kids that we talk to are wanting to be that production person, you know, that's what they're going for, is they're trying to work their way up that ladder to be in charge. And I'm thinking,
and they're going to tell you it's going to be a 3-day shoot and you'll be needed for all 3 days. So if you're in Atlanta, it means you're going to either have to spend a night or you're going to have to drive back and forth to Atlanta three times, and you got to be there on time. And sometimes they even ask you about your car. What kind of car do you have?
Yeah, they give you bumps. They call them bumps. Yeah. If they can use something, if you're elevated from, you know, to do something special, Now I'll go ahead and tell this story.
Go ahead.
On In Dubious Battle, there, you know, it's set in the 30s, and there was the tent city that was made for the apple pickers to come in, and they were about to work. And with James Franco and a couple of others, they were needing to film a scene at the latrine. Now, the latrine had one board that went across. You know, there was the ditch and the one board that went across, and then another that was kind of like the back support. So they came and said, we're needing a couple of people to be in a scene with James Franco, but involved in this, you know, it's going to be shot from behind, and your bare bottom is going to be hanging out. And for anyone who's chosen to do this, you get a $50 bump.
So, did you raise your hand, or
I passed on that one?
Well, it's according to what format the screen would have been in for. I could have been in if it had been a widescreen.
I think that's kind of funny. I can just imagine the people that volunteered. I mean, or was it just...
Well, they actually chose an older guy. When I say older, he was probably in his early 70s, and a younger guy that's probably late 20s to
participate in that.
And, of course... You know, until the movie is released, we won't know whether that's made. That was one, and it hasn't come out yet, but that was one of the more enjoyable shoots besides 42 from the standpoint. Worked 10 days on it down in Georgia, and they put together, and it was all featured extra work. They put together what they called which I thought was funny since it was about apple pickers, a core group. and so I was part of the core group, which meant that we were in a lot of scenes close up with the actors, in a lot of the mm-hmm. shots. But last month they premiered In Dubious Battle at the in Europe at the Venice Film Festival, mm-hmm. and James Franco received the Best Director Award for In Dubious Battle.
Wow.
So I'm hoping they're looking right now for one of the major studios to pick it up to do the distribution next year. So I'm hoping that one of the major studios picks it up and gets it out there, because it's a the photography in it and the scenery is going to be beautiful.
And where were you in Georgia?
It was down in, there were two locations. One was Senoia, Georgia, which is a city that actually a lot of The Walking Dead is filmed in that area. And the other is a southeast of Athens, Georgia, let's see, southeast of there and northwest of Atlanta, and I can't think of the name mm-hmm. of it, a very small town. The mayor of that town had a 400-acre farm, and they were leasing farm where they filmed mm-hmm. it so that they could keep it private with the access of the public mm-hmm. and everything. But it was a beautiful property, and the scenes that they I saw set up in the monitors, it's going to look really nice on film.
You know, if you have an old historic home, or if you have a big farm like that, you can go to the Tennessee Film Commission and you can list your property with the state, and they may bring a film crew to your property. Now, they're going to intrude your house, you know, so you have to realize that they're going to come in and bring lights and cables and everything into your house, and they need old cars, they need a particular type of... Mm-hmm.
Will got paid for his car in Nashville, too.
Yeah.
They didn't use it, but since he brought it and committed to bringing it, they gave him some little stipend.
Well, I have a friend in Atlanta who, they didn't use her house. She was on a cul-de-sac, mm-hmm. but they were using one of the houses on the cul-de-sac, and the film company came to her prior to filming and said, we're going to be inconveniencing you for a couple of weeks, and you know, we're sorry, but you know, we're willing to pay you $200 a day mm-hmm. just for your inconvenience.
Just go ahead and say 2 weeks.
Yeah. Right. Well, you know, it wasn't. I believe that in The Godfather, there's talk about what house that was, and I think we saw some little documentary or something on TV talking about that. Ron and I saw a fascinating house this week. We went to the National Trail of Tears meeting down in Dalton, and we have a bus trip every year when we go to this National Trail of Tear meetings, and it makes the whole trip. And they took us, put us all on buses, three big chartered buses. We went to New Echota, and we went to the Van House in Spring Place and had lunch. And then they took us down in Gordon County, Georgia, to David Adair's house. He's from the 1790s, and he had a stagecoach stop there, and the Traveler's Rest, the house that the people stayed in, is still there also. His driveway is part of the original road. It's not open to the public yet, but I was just thinking, as you were saying, houses that could be used, three-story high log cabin, and they've gone through and put air conditioning and stuff in, but didn't, you know, tear the house up to do it. You know what I'm saying? It looks like a normal, unbelievable 16 and 18 foot wide planks on the floor. I was in old history lady heaven.
Well, there are several places in Chattanooga, the Chattanooga Film Society and Backlot. If you're interested in making movies or enjoying local movies being made, there are always artists there. There's people showing documentaries or shorts, or this next month they're going to have a makeup expert come in and show people how to do makeup. So if you're interested in that type of stuff, there are facilities around here. I always like to give a political commercial here, not about the presidential race. I don't want to get into that one. But the Tennessee Film Commission is active here, but the state of Tennessee does not allow much tax credit for people to bring films to our state. Georgia does, a lot of other states. And, for example, just the wood they bought for 42 for the fencing out there was $240,000. They completely redone Ingle Stadium that helped save Ingle Stadium quite a bit. So they spent a lot of money, and they got no tax breaks on there. Just fortunately, we had the right. So we could bring more films into Tennessee if that. And you have to contact your state representatives and your state senators and say, you know, support this and for tax credits for that. And some of them seem to think that that doesn't bring any money into our state. 42 brought in a lot of money to the city of Chattanooga.
You know, that's something you've made some really good observations, Ron. That's something that on a state level that we should be doing a lot more of. If there's anyone, any of the politicians, who might be tuned into the station this morning.
They are today. Why not be next week now?
Georgia offers film credits, which attracts the production companies into the states. And one of the things that once they get those credits, they're able to do, if they don't use all of them, they can actually sell them to other companies, which allows them to recoup some of the investment that they're making in the production. That's one of the things that happened in North Carolina last year, is they took away those film credits and the production company started leaving North Carolina. Outside of Hollywood right now, the Atlanta area has more production going on than any other place in the world at this point. Here in the state of Tennessee, we used to have back in the old days the three states of Tennessee. You would see the old road signs where you have West Tennessee, Middle Tennessee, and East Tennessee.
Yes.
We've got a real diverse as far as the mountains and the flatlands and everything, and with all the natural beauty that we have with all the mountains and streams and everything here. There's no reason why, if the state didn't offer more tax incentives to these production companies, that there would be a lot more done here in the state, bringing a lot more jobs, a lot more revenue to the companies. Like you say, just supplying lumber, supplying the labor, besides everything else.
Just think about all the meals, the hotel rooms that 42 brought in, and like I say, just the. The build the green screen down at 42 was $250,000 worth. Not to count putting it up, that was just the cost of the lumber. And then they painted and they fixed up Ingle Stadium. Now they painted it every day, I think. Then they changed it a different color a lot of times.
Every time it was supposed to be a different major league ballpark, they would paint the railing to match what the railing was in that particular city stadium at that time. And I heard the number given at the end of production. that on Engle Stadium they had spent over $700,000 in renovations and on the production part of like the lumber and everything else.
And you talked about this, you know, the rivers, the locations to bigger cities. You know, of course, we got airports. The Railroad Museum out of Chattanooga is a great place for railroad. And then Engle Stadium for baseball pictures. You're talking about some really great places, the Smoky Mountains, all this. So there's a great opportunity for them to bring business to Tennessee. And, you know, I don't know what the tax credit is, but some tax credit's better than none at all. But there's a lot of money.
The Railroad Museum has been used several times.
Oh, yeah. So.
Ron, I wanted to mention that next week's show will be Brian Reed and I. We're going to be disturbing the dead. We're going to be talking about Fort Hill Cemetery, always a popular program with our listeners. We'll also be talking about the cemetery tour. Put that on your agenda on the last Sunday in October, starting about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. They'll be having the tours that will be conducted by the history students from Lee University. The folks have been selected. Most of them are women characters this year. And you will have a guide that will take you from cemetery plot to cemetery plot, and that person is standing there dressed as the person telling their story, which in turn tells Cleveland's history. But it's always a very entertaining evening and a good way to learn history and be out in our beautiful historic center,
which goes to the history program over at Lee University
to fund scholarships for history majors.
So what is it, $5 or $10?
Oh, it's just $5.
$5 to go through it. It's a grade. It takes you about an hour.
Plan on at least an hour. And if you get there at a real busy time, you may have to wait 20 minutes. And then, or if you would like to be a tour guide, you can volunteer by calling Lee University Historical Center or the History Department at Lee University. I'm sure that they would take, a lot of times it's other Lee students. Sometimes it's local historians like me. They can't let me do it. Because every tombstone I see, I have a story for it, and we would never get to the next actor.
Have we mentioned all the movies you've been in? Have you named them all yet?
That's enough. That's
what else?
Let me flip the table around here for a second, if I could.
Go ahead.
And I know a lot of your listeners are aware of this, but just from the standpoint of, with, you know, my hometown, you know, Cleveland and everything, I want to thank you and Debbie for everything that you're doing. I mean, what a legacy that you're creating with all the work that you're doing with the documentaries and the documentation of the history of Cleveland and the surrounding area. It's remarkable.
Thank you. We work hard, but we certainly enjoy it. And this week at the National Trail of Tears meeting, it was a bit of a, I wouldn't call it a sensation, but there was a lot of chatter about a book that I'm working on now that, you know, I just thought, well, it's this little reference book, it'll be okay, but it's something from the removal that's never been done. And all the properties here in Bradley County that belong to the Cherokees, they were evaluated before they were removed. And so from somebody that's, their family's been in Oklahoma since 1830-something, they could possibly see what their grandfather's farm was worth. A lot of the farms, I can pretty much at least pinpoint a community that they're in, so they can come stand at least close to where their grandpa's property was. So I think that's going to be really exciting, and I've got to get it finished. It's turned into a big project, hasn't it, Ron?
Yes, it has.
Well, every time he looks at me, I'll tell him.
Thank you, Gary. We've been doing this 7.5 years here on the station, and we did it just because as we went around town, you know, people would stop and ask us tons of questions about history. And I said, we ought to do a little program down on Whoop, and we called Mr. Jones, and he said, yeah, go on. And we did it an hour the first week, an hour second week, and we've been 2 hours for the last 7.5 years now. And sometimes we don't get done at 12 o'clock.
Yeah.
Well, I know both of you enough that I know that it's a labor of love. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's obvious that you know, you thoroughly enjoy what you're doing, but I think you also understand what you're doing from the standpoint of, you know, you're creating something that's going to endure beyond, you know, your lifetime, that pass on to generations to come that are really going to look back have a real appreciation for the time and the hours and the days and the weeks and the months mm-hmm. and the years that you've put into the projects that you've done and the projects yet to come.
Tim, we're not ever like, what's our next project going to be? It's which one of these projects are we going to do next?
since you mentioned that, every week we record these programs. They will be available on YouTube about Tuesday or Wednesday of next week. So if you didn't get to hear this or you'd like to see it again, or you can, we'll put that out on our Facebook page, Old Town Cleveland. Or if you'd like to join Old Town Cleveland Facebook page, has more members than Facebook will allow now. So we have Friends of Old Town Cleveland. So you can join there instantly, or you can wait in line to be on Old Town Cleveland, and it's a long waiting list. But you get the same thing on both of them. We post the same pictures and stories, and so we appreciate it. But Gary's always a good friend from many, many years ago, and it's time to go. You got any final comment?
No, I just, thank both of you. Appreciate you inviting me to join you today. It's I'm just truly blessed to have had all of the adventures that I've had so far. It's I don't understand why God chose me to reach down and give me these blessings, but I'll just say thank you, Lord, and I'll do the best I can to be mm-hmm. the best man.
I hope
that
your
I can.
Wife is keeping a good scrapbook for you.
Morgan, you need to get to school to have him come up and speak to your classes, because
I'll definitely give that a shot.
Yeah, so all
he's
these
doing
young,
all the audio visual stuff at Bradley. Yeah. That would be a good idea, because I think the kids might have a misconception, as I did, about how things worked, and maybe you could encourage them to try out to be extras.
Well, folks, we every week we have our final comments here, and basically it's the same thing every week. Go get those pictures from out from under the bed, out of the shoe boxes, out of the drawers. Get someone in your family and get some archival ink and labels to put on the back of the picture. Who's in those pictures? Because when members of your families pass, so does your family's history. Our community history passes away, so it's very, very important to do that. Get you a small camera and record your mom, your dad, your grandpas, your grandmothers. You'll love those old tapes 20 years from now when you can hear your grandfather's voice again. You'll really appreciate that. So, but see if we get it right here.
Let's pray.
And let's see. We'll always remember Pearl Harbor.
But will we remember Aunt Pearl? All
right, we will see you next week here on Old Town Cleveland. Bye-bye,
hello,
y'all.
I'm Shelley Duvall.
And you're listening to WOOPLP, Cleveland, Tennessee. Whoop FM is a broadcasting service of the Traditional Music Resource Center, and we play America's original music.
Check into Cash. The cash you need today is waiting for you at Check Into Cash. It's your money, so come in and get it.
Get a payday advance today for up to $425. At Check Into Cash, we make it quick, easy, and confidential.
The cash you need is right here, so stop worrying and stop in to Check Into Cash today.
Borrowers often use payday advances over a period of months, which can be expensive. Restrictions apply. See store for details.
You need a little green lending. Frog is making deals. He'll lend you cash on any kind of wheels. Borrow just a little, or you can borrow big. Lending Frog is a new financial gig. It's hip to hop, it's hip to hop into cash. LendingFrog.com is making a splash.
Take it, take it.
Good evening, sir. Do you got any more of these free packages of cat and dog food?
If you're looking for a home, apartment, or office space, Jones Properties provides residential and commercial properties in the heart of the Southeast that will fulfill any need. Plus, Jones Properties is one of the fastest growing firms in the area, which offers you more security. When you're ready for a home, apartment, or in need for commercial office space, it makes sense to call Jones Properties first at 472-4000. Plus, you can get additional information by logging on to the website at www.jonesproperties.biz. Jones Properties is also looking to invest in properties. So if you have a property that you need to sell, call the professional team at Jones Properties first. They'll help you find the perfect property for whatever your needs. Call today, 472-4000. And don't forget to keep up with Jones Properties on Facebook.
Nashville Cats play clean as country water. Nashville Cats play wild as Mountain Dew. Nashville Cats been playing since they's babies. Nashville Cats get work before they're just